Wow.
Amen. Isn't it good to worship the Lord? It is. It's taste and see how good He is. Amen. This morning, as I share with you in the next few moments, I don't know about you, but I'm doing this thing about encountering God. And Larry, I really appreciate that video. That was a good clip. And experiencing God in our lives, and you know, and in that light, not missing God in our lives, and realizing that He is there and He's involved in our lives. Carolyn shared a story with me this week, and a couple stopped in a restaurant here in Southern Illinois, and as they were sitting in the restaurant, two elderly ladies come in and sat down at a table kind of close to where they were sitting. And as the couple was sitting there, God spoke to their heart and said, "You need to buy these two elderly ladies' meal." So when the waitress come by, the couple said, "Just give us their ticket. We're going to buy their meal." Well, anyway, the waitress went back around, and one lady had went to the restroom, and the other elderly lady was sitting there, and the waitress went by, and she said, "Hey," she said, "your meal has been taken care of." And the lady said, "What do you mean, our meal?" I said, "The couple sitting over there said God spoke to their heart and said that they was going to buy your meal," and said this lady just broke down and started weeping. And the waitress said, what's going on?" And she said, "My friend who's in the restroom just lost her husband." And her words were, "When we come to this restaurant, I just don't know whether God exists. He's going to have to reveal Himself to me." Can you imagine that? Can you imagine? Isn't that experiencing God? Isn't that seeing God in your life? And I thought, wow, what a phenomenal thing that, you know, the people were sensitive enough to buy the meals. And here's the lady saying, "Well, I just don't know whether God, you know, I want to trust and believe in God, what, however she said all that. And then I'm just going to have to see." And I thought, well, so as we go through this, I want you to think about experiencing God. And I want you to think about this message as to listen with an open heart and an open mind. Make a decision to get involved. And ask God to give you Holy Spirit direction and wisdom to fulfill your part. Some of you may know Jim Murphy. Jim Murphy lives in DuCoin. And I was with Jim Friday evening. And Jim, on the 28th of this month, along with several other guys, are doing a special thing in East St. Louis. And I was up there with him a couple years ago. And there's a little church there in East St. Louis, and that little church has kind of adopted some of the guys, and they've been working with that little church. And they've had some really neat things, but God spoke to Jim Murphy and told him, he said, "Jim, I want you to do something special in East St. Louis." Well, Jim is, he's really a hunter and a fisherman and a retired coal miner. And so Jim's, he was telling me, he said, "I just was honest with God." He said, "God, I don't think I've got the ability, you know, to do something special up there. But," he said, "if you want me to do it, you have to speak to my heart." And Jim said he always takes a walk when he wants to seek God out in the country. And he said, "I was walking out," and he said, "God literally," he said, "literally overcome me and begin to speak to my heart." And he said, when he ended it, he said he showed me the most beautiful sunset I've ever seen in my life. And he said, "I got home," and he said, "all I responded was, 'God, I'll do it without question.'" And he said, "when I got home, I had the first phone call when I walked in the house, and a guy said, 'I believe God's speaking to your heart about doing something in East St. Louis. I'm in.' And he said, 'I'll donate $400 to start off.'" I'd say he was in, wouldn't you? And so what Jim has done, they're on the 28th of July, they're going up, and there is a lot there, two or three lots right close to this church. They've cleaned that lot off, and they're going to build a ball diamond there. But what they're going to do on the 28th is they're giving away two bicycles, They're taking food, and he's had more food, and he said, I know what to do with, and we're donating food, and we've had clothes. We've got ball gloves, and we've got baseball bats, and we've got baseball equipment, and they're going to spend the day. The police department found out about it up there, and they said, we're in. The fire department found out about it, said, we're in. And they're going to barbecue and have brats and hot dogs, and they got clowns, and they're going to do the whole thing, and it's going to be an all-day affair. Now, isn't that getting involved with God? You know, and the neat thing about it is that it's in East St. Louis, and I remember the couple of years ago, or when it was, I was there, of standing on a street with my arm around this black lady, and I remember she looked up at me, and her eyes was great big, and she said, never in my life would I ever dream I would be standing on this street with a white man with his arms around me. but was able to share, you know, the love of Christ. So I want you to listen to this. I want you to ask God to give you open heart and open mind. Ask God to speak to your heart that you would want to get involved and allow God. Now I want you to think about this. Encountering God and becoming a God chaser. And listen to this passage of Scripture in Isaiah, the 6th chapter, in verse 1 through 5. It says, in the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. And above it stood a seraphim, and each one had 6 wings. With 2 he covered his face, with 2 he covered his feet, and with 2 he flew. And one cried to another, saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is filled with his glory. And the posts of the door were shaken by the voice of him who cried out, and the house was filled with smoke. So I said, woe is me, for I am undone, because I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the glory of the Lord of hosts. Now, if you stop there on that passage, but I want you to look down, if you turn there, and in verse 8, it said that, who shall I send? Who shall go for us? And Isaiah said, Lord, send me. I'll go. I'll go and share the message. I'll go and tell the story. I'll go and allow you to work through me. Now, how many of you believe that ought to be a challenge? That we surrender to God, because what he did, he says, I surrender, God. I saw you, and I encountered you, and I've had an experience with you. And he says, woe is me, because in the light of God, he says, I'm unclean. But God touched him, and his response, here I am, send me. How many of you believe that was a good response from Jim Murphy? Yeah. Matter of fact, I got something I want to put on the bulletin board for you to look at. Remember Ferguson, Missouri? Remember all the horrible things that happened at Ferguson, Missouri? Remember all the chaos and confusion? Well, I want you to look at this pictures here. In our meeting Friday night, our group of guys worked Ferguson, Missouri during the 4th of July. And you'll find Jim Murphy down here in the corner in a neighborhood kneeling down with black children all around him. And Jim told me, he said, Gerald, he said, I've been a hunter all my life. And he said, I've been a dog trainer. And he said, I've trained all kind of hunting dogs. And he said, I was up on the streets of Ferguson, and we was in these neighborhoods, and they were passing out material and passing out food and all different kind of things. And all these people from Ferguson began to gather in these neighborhoods. And Jim said, God spoke to my heart. And he said, son, he said, when you get down on your knees sometime to relate to a dog, he said, won't you try it with these children? And Jim said, I got down on my knees. And he said, God began to bring these kids around. And he said, I shared the love of Christ with them. And so you can see that picture there with them people around him. And here's the neat thing. The news did not say one thing about this, but they literally infiltrated all of Ferguson, and the response, they passed out food, they loved people, they had clowns, and they did all kind of neat things, and they had barbecues in the backyards of people in Ferguson and during the 4th of July. Isn't that pretty neat? How many believe that? That's God doing something beyond the normal. But you know, the news media didn't say a word about that. Isn't that amazing? But here they were up there, and guys that we're talking about, The Okies were up there with them, and Jim Murphy, Cliff Harrell was up there. I don't know how many different people were up there, but they were sharing the love of Christ, and they simply was willing to surrender to God. And you know what? Here's the thing. Ask God to make you a blessing. Wouldn't you agree, the stories that I've told you so far, that the couple, God made them a blessing. God used him. God is using Jim Murphy. God is using different people as you open up. But you have to make the decision. Say, I want to surrender to God. God, I want to be a blessing, and I want to step out of my comfort zone. How many realize that's a tough one? You know, we all have comfort zones, and we all have, walls of petition. But I believe in these last days, God is wanting us to get out of our comfort zone, be willing to step up. I was in this meeting Friday night. They kind of call us the senior advisors. I don't know whether I like that statement or not. But we sat down and we began to listen to these younger guys and what God's doing in their lives. And I sat there and I thought, God, I almost feel embarrassed to say I'm their senior advisor. Listening what God had done in these men's life, listening how God was using these men to touch people's lives, and realizing that these guys and gals were going the extra mile to get involved. The back page of this will be on that bulletin board. Troy Benetone is from Marion, Illinois. Used to be an insurance salesman, but God spoke to Troy. And I think they've started over 25 churches in Asia, or in the area, the Asian area. And it's amazing, not only have they started over 25 churches, they've set up a seminary and they've trained ministers and they've trained workers. And there's pictures of them meeting with a lot of the workers and the new pastors that's going into these 25 churches. And isn't that amazing? This is from Southern Illinois, guys. Doesn't that excite you a little bit? And so what I want you to think about in 2 Chronicles 6:19, it says, "For the eyes of the Lord range throughout the whole earth to show himself strong for those whose hearts are completely his." I want you to understand about experiencing God or encountering God. God wants to be involved in your life. God wants to work in your life on an everyday basis. And so here's the simple little things that I want you to think about. Simple things. Commit to 3 daily intentions to follow Christ more closely. How many of you think devotion life is important? How many of you think prayer time is important? How many being still with God, you see, but to follow Christ more closely, to love more openly, and to incarnate God's grace more clearly. Now, how many of you believe when it incarnate, in other words, bring God's grace into everyday living? How many of you believe the stories that I've told you, they brought grace more clearly into people's lives? Can you imagine how those people in Ferguson, Missouri felt, all of these white people coming in there sharing the love of God and willing to make sacrifice and willing to reach out and give of their time, their resources, their ability, and yet the impact that it's had. And you know, here's the interesting thing. You know who appreciates them as much as anybody? The police. Because they realized when they went in there, they didn't cause a disruption. They didn't cause rioting. They caused the love and peace of God to rule in that neighborhood. And so I want you to think about this. These are decisions. Ask yourself 3 simple questions. How shall I follow Jesus today? And how can I demonstrate Jesus' love today? How can I play my part in participating or practicing the presence of Christ right here, right now? How many of you realize Ava, Illinois? Of saying, I need to ask him to help me show myself strong in behalf of that. You know, I had the reversal. I think I've told this story, but I had the reversal of happening to me going through McDonald's. There was a big long line of at McDonald's, and I let this car that nobody would let her in into the thing. And when I went to turn my order in, the lady said, whatever you order is paid for. I said, what do you mean? She said, that lady that you led in the line said nobody else would do it, and it must be a nice guy, and so she bought my breakfast. Well, actually, me and Carolyn's breakfast that morning. But isn't that neat? But I mean, just experiencing and saying, God, I want to share your love. I want to be involved. Number three, find time each day to be still in order to hear his gracious voice, relying on the Holy Spirit to help you resist the culture of noise and constant stimulation. I put that in there, and I want you to think about that. How many realize we live in a busy world? How many realize there's a lot of demands on your life? How many realize you create most of those? Oh, I wasn't supposed to talk that way. But aren't we guilty of creating all of these demands and all these pressures? We have different expectations. But here's the thing. Find time. Take time to be still in order to hear his gracious voice. How many believe he wants to speak to you? You see, but you have to make the decision that I'm going to take time. And you're going to have to rely on the Holy Spirit to be able to motivate you and speak to your heart. Because if you don't, you're going to miss. And you know how you're going to miss it? Being too busy. Trying to do too many different things. And then the last one, answer the call to costly discipleship. A discipleship which seeks to enact and embody and incarnate Christ's presence in the context of the world which you live and are called to service or serve. Now, as you think about these guys, I want you to understand that it's going to take some God-sized thinking. God's got to enlarge our vision. God's got to enlarge our standing. God's got to be able to speak to our hearts. You know, one of the, I think, the most difficult things that I've seen, I'll speak for myself. I'm going to speak for somebody else, but I'll speak for myself, that I can find all kinds of reasons why I shouldn't do something. I can find all kinds of excuses why I shouldn't do it. But you know what? We need to come to a decision that if God's speaking to my heart, if God speaks to your heart, how many of you believe he'll enable you to do that? That's what Jim Murphy found out, that he thought, I'll just be honest with God. I don't think I can pull this off. And you know, one of the neat things, Abby Emling is really a neat lady. You know Abby and Adam. And Abby is Fred Bishop's secretary. She ought to have many stars in her crown to be Fred's secretary. And for all the years that she's been Fred's secretary. But one thing Abby Emling can do, she can organize and put things together better than anybody I've ever seen. Matter of fact, she's the secretary at the Methodist Church and Fred's secretary. That she works a half a day at the church and a half a day at Fred's office. And when I was pastoring at DuCoin, Spirit of Life, I every once in a while I'd drop by Abby and I'd say, Abby, whatever it takes, I want you as my secretary. I want you to be my secretary. Well, God had something better or as good and gave me a secretary that was just like Abby. And what a blessing that was. But Abby Emling heard Jim Murphy, and she heard something in Jim Murphy. And so she said, I went home. And I thought, man, I'm way too busy to get involved in anything else. But she said, God kept burdening my heart. God kept speaking to me. And finally she called Jim and she said, Jim, would you like to have a little help? Jim said, oh, would I? Would I love to have the help? And so Abby is the one that got behind Jim and with the organization and the administrative ability and has put all of this stuff together and got all the pieces fitting together. Shane Bishop's church up in Fairview Heights, they've sending quite a few people. Several churches have rallied together. They're going to pull this thing off on July the 20th. Don't you think we ought to pray for them? That God will bless them and it'll be something very special. But now, here's what I want you to look with me. And this thing, God-sized thinking. God-sized thinking is looking beyond the physical limitations of this world and sees every circumstance, every problem, every phase of life as an opportunity for God to intervene with his love and his power, and to make a victorious way. Charlie's got a great testimony that refocusing, didn't you, Charlie, and saying, wow, I've always believed that he could make a way where there seemed to be no way. And Charlie said, I lost that a little bit, but God gave it back, and he began to bless in Charlie's life. Isn't that a good testimony? Amen? But I want you to understand, as we look to God, God-sized thinking says, I don't see any limitations. God-sized thinking says, I see problems as the only way for me to work my grace in and through your life. But here's what I want you to do in the next few moments. I want you to watch this video. This is an old video that we've done, and you can see how old it is because it's got pictures of the old church in it. But it's the God of this city. And I want you to watch this video, and I want you to see and catch something about our city of Ava, that God is the God of this city, that God desires to do something special in this city. Not only that, I want you to realize God wants us to do something special in this city, to touch people's lives, all right? Larry, are we ready? Okay. Jerry, can you dim the...
You're the God of this city, you're the King of these people, you're the Lord of this nation, you are. You're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless, you are. There is no one like our God. Is no one like our God. For greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. You're the God of this city, you're the King of this people, you're the Lord of this nation, you are. You're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless, you are. There is no one like I. There is no one.
You know, Mr. Wilson, he always gets a little upset with me because I have the tractor and the cow. But you know what? His testimony needs to be proclaimed. Him and Karen. Because God took something very small and turned it into something very large. And God is blessed. And not only that, has God blessed Jerry and Karen, but they have been a blessing. And they've been touching people's lives. And so I think it's a great ending because it's a great testimony. It's a great story of what, you know, to start with almost nothing. And that big old bull was what, the nation's number one bull, you know, and beautiful. No, it is beautiful in that sense. But you see, I want you to understand that God wants to bless our church. God wants to bless our town of Ava. God wants to bless Southern Illinois. God wants to work through you and I as individuals and as a group of believers that we can have impact. You know, one of the things that we don't talk much about, but for Corliss, about 14 months now, maybe 15 months, we've been doing the acts of kindness. And it's amazing that God's blessed us, but every month for maybe 15 months, I don't know, Ann kind of helps us keep track of that, but we've done an act of kindness, and we've given $250 for 15 months or somewhere in that vicinity to help somebody in need. And you know what? It's always interesting how that it always pops up. There seems like somebody's attention to come, that there's a need, and we can rally to that. But I want you to, you know, that's doing something to say God loves people in this community. Amen? That's a way of touching people's lives. We've done all different kind of things. We even done the thing, the discount up at the restaurant and the placemats and all of that. But I want you to see this. For any church to succeed, it needs three things. And I want you to look at these three areas. A passionate visionary. And when I'm talking about a passionate visionary, people who allow God to birth a vision within their heart and become a very, very passionate in starting or helping build the work of God. Now, the story I told you, I wanted to use that as because Jim allowed God to plant a vision in his heart. Jim began to get very passionate about it, and God began to add people like Abby who caught the vision with him, who became very passionate about it, who began to put all the pieces together. And as the story was told, you know, I love the one guy that bought the bicycles. The guy that bought the bicycles, he called Jim, and he said, "Jim, I'll buy the bicycles." And you know what he said? Don't buy cheap ones either. He said, get the best that you can get. And so that's what they did. They're going to give a girl's bicycle away on the 28th, and they're going to give a boy's bicycle away. But the guy was very passionate about it. He said, this don't buy something cheap. This do something and make it a quality bike. And you know what? Here's the interesting thing. You know how God works? The tollers with the store uptown. Jim went into the store. They got to talk, and they said, what are you buying bicycles for? And he said, he told them the story, and they said, well, I tell you what, you buy one, we'll donate one. So now he's had all the money, so they turn around and put that in something else, as because the tollers caught the vision and got passionate about it and said, you buy one, we'll donate one. Isn't that pretty neat how God puts the pieces together? And so I want you to see that as we talk about experiencing God, that if you'll be sensitive and go back to these things and say, God, I want to hear you on a daily basis, God will begin to speak to your heart. And the Bible is full of people that God spoke to their heart, ordinary people like you and I, that he began to put a vision, he began to put a dream into their heart, he began to touch their lives, and they became very passionate. Can you imagine Noah building an ark in the desert? That's pretty heavy, isn't it? I mean, you'd have to be pretty passionate about that to say, I want to do that. And yet, to turn around and tell people, I'm going to build a boat in the desert. And yet, he was passionate about it. And I mean, it's one story after another. Abraham comes home and tells Sarai, he said, God spoke to my heart and we're moving. She said, where are we going? He said, I don't know. God said he'll show it, went away. You have to be passionate about that. You'd have to be willing to say, wow, I believe I've heard God's voice. I want to be obedient. But here's the neat thing. Look at this. Number two is passionate volunteers, people who catch the vision because of the passion of the visionary and of give of their time, give of their ability. When you say, Abby caught that vision, the guy that donated the money, and the other guy called and said, I'll give you $400. And even at the hardware store, catching the vision of being a part of that. But you see, here's what we need. Right here in Ava, Illinois, at Kincaid Christian Fellowship, we need people to catch visions and dreams, and we need to have people get passionate about joining in and saying, we'll roll our sleeves up and we'll work together, because then you have passionate donors, people who will give of their resources to advance God-sized thinking and make it a reality in their community. How many realize it's been because of your giving that we've been able to do those acts of kindness and be able to touch people's lives? But you see, as we go through this, as a pastor, I know I get pretty passionate. I get pretty emotional. I get pretty worked up. And I don't, you know, I hope I never get offensive, and I don't mean to be offensive. But there are certain things in my life that, man, God starts to stir in it. I'm just an emotional person. And I get pretty passionate about certain things, and I get pretty sincere about different areas of my life, and I don't mean to offend. It's just a part of me. That's why sitting in that meeting Friday night, I sat there and just kind of wept, because I thought, God, I feel pretty humbled right now, thinking that we're supposed to be the senior advisor, and I'm hearing what God's doing in all of these young people and how God's using their life. Fred Bishop, I guess he sensed something was going on in my life, and he looked over and he said, son, he said, you're too old to get involved. And I said, no, I'm not, Fred. I said, I feel that stirring in my heart. And so I want you to allow God to create some passionate vision in you, and passionate enough that you'd volunteer and get involved in what God is trying to do here in Southern Illinois, and see what God is doing. Now, I want to jump ahead here. Two biblical principles that will produce success in a church. It's all about God. How many of you agree with that? And live every day expecting to experience God, to see and hear and encounter Him. Everything is possible with God. How many of you believe that? Everything is possible. But you see, if you'll take these two biblical principles and turn about and say, wow, it's not about me. It's not about, you know, what I want. It's all about God. Can I hear an amen out of that too? And I want you to look at this in Romans 11 and verse 33 through 36. And let me read this to you. And it says, oh, what a wonderful God we have. Let's stop there. Can everybody say amen to that? Oh, what a wonderful God we have. How great are His wisdom and knowledge and riches. How impossible it is for us to understand His decisions and His methods. Or who among us can know the mind of the Lord? Who knows enough to be His counselor and guide? And who could ever offer to the Lord enough to induce Him to act? For everything comes from God alone, and everything lives by His power, and everything is for His glory. To Him be glory evermore. Now, how many realize He's a big God? How many realize that God's ways are higher and better than our way? And so here's the interesting thing. We need to fall in love with Him, make Him the priority in our lives. And it's basically what Matthew 22 says, that you love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your ability, everything about you, fall in love with Him. But now, I'm kind of speeding through this. How many of you realize if it's all about Him, then shouldn't we have absolute surrenderance? Shouldn't we surrender to Him? Shouldn't we say, God, I submit to You. I surrender. I want to hear You. I want to serve You. I want to please You. I want to follow You. I want to encounter You in my life. And I love D.L. Moody, Moody Bible Institute. D.L. Moody was an evangelist that lived back in the 1800s. You know, D.L. Moody, you know what D.L. Moody was before he became an evangelist? Anybody know much about D.L. Moody? D.L. Moody was a shoe salesman. And God began to speak to D.L. Moody and call him into a walk with Him. And D.L. Moody tells the story that he went to a prayer meeting. And Jerry, you know where they had the prayer meeting? Out in a hayfield. Out in a hayfield. And the guy that was named Henry Varley. And Henry Varley went to that prayer meeting out in the hayfield. And D.L. Moody was wrestling about whether God was speaking to his heart, whether God was calling him in to be a missionary or an evangelist, whether God was doing this. And here's what Henry Varley said to D.L. Moody. It says, "The world has yet to see what God can do with and for and through and in a man who is fully and wholly committed and consecrated to him." Now think about this. The world has yet to see what God can do with and for and through and in a man who is fully and wholly committed and consecrated, surrendered to him. D.L. Moody began to weigh that out. And D.L. Moody, he finally come to this decision. He said, "I realized that he wasn't just talking about one man. He was talking about any man who would surrender himself to God. I realized he was talking about any person, any man, woman, or child who would surrender themselves to God. God could work powerfully in their lives." And so he said, "I've made that decision." There's Moody Bible College. There's Moody Radio Station. There's Moody all kinds of things that started back in that hayfield back in the 1800s. And that God has touched multiplied people's lives. D.L. Moody, revival after revival. He was the Billy Graham of the 1800s. And God worked powerfully in his life. And you know, he had no education whatsoever. Very little education. But God took him and used him in a powerful way. And you see, Romans 12, 1 and 2. "I beseech you by the mercies of God that you present" what? "Your life, your body, as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service." Why would it be your reasonable service? Well, here's the neat thing about it. If God loved you enough to send his son to die on a cross, if God loved you enough that Jesus would suffer humility, be humiliated, would be tortured, would be nailed to a cross, and died for your sins, wouldn't it be a reasonable service to say, "I surrender, I submit to him, I surrender my life to him"? Undoubtedly, he loves me so much. Undoubtedly, he has got a way and a plan that is much better than mine. And so I submit to him. Now, I'm going to close with this. And I want you to listen to this. Deuteronomy 28. I've held on to Deuteronomy 28 for more years than I can imagine. And I've paraphrased it. I've rewritten Deuteronomy 28 in modern language. I've done all kinds of things with Deuteronomy 28. But I want you to listen to it as I close and we read Deuteronomy 28. It says, "Now," starting with verse 1, "it shall come to pass, if you diligently obey the voice of the Lord your God, to observe carefully all his commandments which I command you today, that the Lord your God will set you high above the nations of the earth, and all these blessings shall come upon you and overtake you because you obey the voice of the Lord." Okay, now, that's a pretty good setting, isn't it? And listen to what it said. "Blessed shall you be in the city. Blessed shall you be in the country. Blessed shall you be in the fruit of your body, the produce of your ground, and the increase of your herds, and the increase of your cattle, and the offspring of your flock. Blessed shall your basket and your kneading bowl. Blessed shall you be when you come in, and blessed shall you be when you go out. The Lord will cause your enemies who rise against you to be defeated before your face. They shall come against you one way and flee before you seven ways." How many realize God breaks the forces of evil up, scatters the forces of evil that come against you? Okay? "The Lord will command the blessings on you in your storehouses and in all to which you set your hand. He will bless you in the land which the Lord your God has given you. The Lord will establish you as a holy people to himself, just as he has sworn to you. If you keep the commandments of the Lord your God and walk in his way, then all the people of the earth will see that you are called by the name of the Lord, and they shall be afraid of you. And the Lord will grant you plenty of goods in the fruit of your body, in the increase of your livestock, in the produce of your ground, in the land which the Lord swore to your fathers to give you. The Lord will open to you his good treasures, the heavens, to give the rain to your land in a season, and will bless the work of your hand. You shall lend to many nations, but you shall not borrow. And the Lord will make you the head and not the tail, and you shall be above only and not beneath, if you heed the commandments of the Lord, which I command you today, and are careful to observe them. So shall you not turn aside from any of the words which I command you this day, to the right or to the left, to go after other gods or to serve them. Now, God, I get pretty passionate, but I cannot ever emphasize enough to you, in developing a personal, meaningful, everyday relationship with God, and developing that, and determining at the beginning that I will commit to these areas in my life. I will commit to seek him. I will commit to serve him. I will commit to be obedient to him. I will commit to take time out of my busy schedule to hear and allow God to speak to my heart. I cannot describe the blessings that will be in your life. I cannot describe to you how God will work powerfully in your lives. And I cannot, emphasize enough how much God wants to do that. And let me bring it down into the present. You see, paraphrased, we are God's chosen people. Do you realize that? We're a chosen generation. God's called us out of the darkness into his marvelous light, that we should show forth the praises of that. That we should be lights and example of what God is doing in our lives, okay? And not only that, that experience God and expect to experience him on a daily basis, that he wants to be involved in everything we do. When we set our hand to do something, he wants to be involved in it. When we go about doing life, he wants to be involved in it. Much more than just going to church on Sunday morning. Much more than reading your Bible. Getting involved where you realize that he cares about you and he wants to work powerfully, 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 powerfully in your life. Can I hear an amen out of that? You see, if we can catch a vision here and allow God to create a passion in our hearts that we can have an impact on Ava in Southern Illinois, I believe at the depths of my heart. But you know what? It takes each one of us. Each one of us. You know, some of you, have a vision. Some of you will catch the vision with that person. Some of you will be able to give, or some of you will be able to give a talent or ability. But all of it will work to bring glory and honor to him. Amen? But you see, we have to make those decisions to say, wow, I want to surrender to him, and I want to be about what he wants. Think about this. You know what God desires of each one of us? He wants us to be his hands. He wants us to be his feet. He wants us to be his voice. He wants us to represent him in Ava, Illinois. How many of you believe he's the God of this city? How many of you believe he's the God of Southern Illinois? And you know how that'll be more of a reality? When we step up to the plate and become a living demonstration of that. Amen? Let's stand together this morning.
Pastor?
Yes. Amen. I agree. Amen. You know, share that voice, okay? You tell them that they're welcome here and they will be loved. Can I tell you one last story? Made me think of it. Jim Murphy told me, Gerald, I went to this meeting and he said there was a drug addict and an alcoholic and said he was really struggling. And said he was searching for something, and he said nobody was paying much attention to him. And so he said, I went and sat down beside him. And he said, I just put my arm around him. He said, man, I just want you to tell you that God loves you. I said, that guy looked at him like he was nuts. And Jim said, no, I just want you to tell you God loves you, and I love you, and I want to pray for you. And Jim said, I laid hands on that guy, and I began to pray for him. And he said, the Holy Spirit began to touch that guy. I said, he began to weep, and he began to cry, and he said he poured his whole heart out sitting there with Jim and received Christ into his life. And he said, you could see this glow come over this guy. And he said, guess who went to Ferguson with me? That guy. Because he said, I found a Savior who set me free. How many believe we can do it right here in Ava?
Yes. I love you.
Amen.
And the Lord spoke to me and said, he got this bag. He told my mom had brought me, and I lost. So I went in my room, crawled in the closet.
Wow.
Hard passing, telling me, Mom, please don't. Mm-hmm. Because God had told me my future would kill him. She gave me, come out here. We went through all the dirty clothes she'd already been. We went in the dirty washer.
Behind the washer. Well, well.
I love God. And I have so, you know, in the Bible where there's evil.
Mm-hmm.
Well, all my life, that's what I've always toward you.
Well.
For that are suffering.
Mm-hmm. Well, well.
And I want to help the soul. And sometimes God will give me the words.
Amen. Guys, gather around. Can we pray for you? Okay. Dave, grab her by the hand, Carolyn. Some of you ladies gather around. Bill, I'm glad you're here, buddy. And let's pray for Bill, too. And let's just gather around them. You know, if old Jim Murph could grab that guy. Amen. Wow. Praise God. Got him? Got him up there. Steve, I'm just going to put my hand on you, okay? Just praise God. Not by word, but by power and demonstration of the Holy Spirit. Father, we join our faith together. And Father, we speak life. Father, we speak deliverance. We speak healing. The manifestation of your grace and power to work powerfully at this very moment. Wow. Wow. We, by faith, release your Holy Spirit to give power and strength and victory in the name of Jesus. Father, to raise up a voice or voices. Yes, Father God. Thank you, Father God. Oh, Father, we bind every force of darkness and every force of evil. We bind it in the name of Jesus. Wow. Commanded to flee and be gone, and we loose at the same time the power of your Holy Ghost to work powerfully, powerfully in Bill and Father, powerfully. Wow. Thank you, Father God. Thank you, Father God. Use these two. Make them vessels that will bring light and glory and a voice here in Ava. Wow. Set the captive free now in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Father God. Wow. Thank you, Father God. Wow. Thank you, Father God. Wow.